You may go now, sir.
Okay. So I am going to begin. So welcome, everyone. We are gathered here today to remember and celebrate the work of Dhirubhai Sheth, who left us recently. Dhirubhai was born in the village of Vadarpur in the Chota Udaipur district of Gujarat in 1936. Dhirubhai, as you all know, was among the founders of CSDS, joining the center in November 1964, and was closely associated with it till his retirement in 1996. Now, how do we remember this remarkable scholar and activist in this moment of collective pain and non-stop tragedy that faces us today in India during this pandemic? Every one of us has been touched personally by this moment. We have grieved every day. Years ago, in the late 1990s, during one of the long evening addas at the center, Dhirubhai shared with me his childhood memory of the day of Gandhi's death. After hearing the news, said Dhirubhai, the entire village went to the riverbank in collective, inconsolable grief. Yet, despite the terrible events of the late 1940s in India, it was the partition and the independence generation that went on to build and shape public and intellectual life. The CSDS, or the center, is a product of these efforts. Dhirubhai was an exemplary thinker of this generation. His was a unique place as a witness and as an interlocutor. His interventions ranged from every facet of India's unique experiment, unique democratic experiment, language, caste, reservations, secularism, the idea of a minority. There is his classic essay on the Hindutva laboratory in his native Gujarat, with lessons for India today. The scope and ambitions of his ideas were staggering, impossible to slot within any received ideology. I imagine all the speakers will be touching on different facets today. To begin, I would like to introduce Ashish Nandi, one of his closest friends, collaborators, and initiators of the CSDS experiment, one of India's best known thinkers. Ashish Nandi, please.
Frankly, I did not want to attend this gathering. I am psychologically in a very rather bad state. There's depression in me, I guess. Clinical depression. 1 year, I am continuously receiving information about death of friends and relatives. And it has come closer and closer. Now you almost feel that your world is about to collapse. Indeed, there is something more to it. Usually when somebody goes, somebody went close to you, you feel there is a gap somewhere now and will be a gap. You try to negotiate that gap by thinking about him or writing about him or rereading what he wrote or said. Now it has gone beyond that. And now I am confronting another kind of death, where the person leaves a gap, all right, but also takes something of you with him or her. And you feel diminished with every such death. Dhirubhai's death is almost, I would put it as the last tread on the back of a very old camel. That's me. And I feel disoriented and unable to even mourn him properly. His death haunts me. In a way, few deaths have haunted me, including those of my relatives. Dhirubhai always took such situations with greater calmness than I had. He had always a different way of looking at it. Indeed, he has a different way of looking at human life and life stories too. And maybe I console myself by telling you one or two of his peculiar ways of grappling with people and grappling and talking about matters of death, life and death. I remember once that I was talking with him and Prakash Desai. And Prakash Desai and I were telling him that he looked depressed, a little bit broken by the death of a friend very close to him in Baroda and later on in the United States. And Prakash, I forget who, said, Vinash did say talk about depression and our unconscious attempts to fight depression in various ways. So Dhirubhai said, look, if you are talking of my own unconscious, because they say, was, by the way, a psychiatrist, psychoanalytical, analyst and a psychiatrist. And two of you, if you are talking about mine, please settle it with my unconscious. I have nothing to do with it. You settle it without me. He had a way of confronting death, which was very different. And even death, he had a different kind of theory. I remember another incident when I was narrating him my experience in Cochin, where I was studying an alternative culture of cosmopolitanism, with which that city has lived for centuries, with 18 communities, and each community proud and self-confident, and each community fully convinced that it was the best among the 18 they knew existed. Now, I also found out during the interviews that each of them thought not only that they were the best, but also believe that when we asked them, that others also seem to be thinking the same way, because I've interviewed others. And I said, and then one respondent said, yes, but they will say that every community thinks it is the best. But despite this fact, the way these communities lived with each other for centuries have lived and done so was remarkable. And I have written a long essay on this many years ago. And I have gone into other versions of such cosmopolitanism elsewhere in South Asia. But let us forget that. What I'm trying to say is, the moment Dhirubhai heard this story, he said, that strikes something, reminds me of something. In my village, when I was very young, a Bhil boy died. And the boy's mother, every evening, loudly sang a marasa and talked with her son in the form of a song. And it lasted for 1 week. And he was absolutely, Dhirubhai says that I was stuck with that thing, because all 7 days, he one by one mentioned each caste, each community, and each sect to his son, dead son, that now you are going to be reborn. Do not be born as a Brahmin, because you will be look at books day in and out, day out, and spoil your eyes. You have beautiful eyes, and you have the eyes, powerful eyes of a real boy. Don't be a boy, be reborn as a Brahmin. And then she went on to, after singing that first kanja, she went on to say, don't be reborn as a baniya, because baniyas are stingy and always counting money. You will waste your life only counting money. And this form of marasya went on for all 7 days. Because the Dhirubhai said, because the thrust was this, that, and she every day she ended the marasya by saying, be reborn only as a hero. That is the best life. That is the best life one can have. Please be reborn as a hero only. So I was trying to say, convey some flavor of the man. I don't want to take too much of your time. I don't have the, I don't even want to speak long. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is this, that Dhirubhai was perhaps the most creative mind I have met in my life. And I've met quite a lot of them, including a large number of very famous people. He always brought something new to the table. He always had an unburdened mind and could think of a thing, any subject in a new way. Not only two big beats sound new, but will bring a fresh look into it, which will open a new path of research for others who were associated with him. He always, when his critics were often so remarkably phrased, that they had in them a subtle hint. I'm sure he always felt this, that if I had written that book, I would have written better. He was a very self-confident person. All I can say is this, that when going, he has not only left a gap in my life, but has taken something of me with him, which will not come back to me. I'm a diminished self. After his death, there have been few others of that kind, and I just say that my ability and capability of mourning these friends too has diminished. I am almost numb. That's that.
Thank you, Ashishda, for that very moving intervention. Thank you for this. I would now like to invite Professor Bhikkhu Parekh, who is a well-known political thinker and philosopher, who very closely knew Dhirubhai, to make his intervention. Professor Parekh.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Thank you. Well, we are assembled here to share our memories of Dhirubhai and to pay tribute to him in our own individual ways. Ashish has done a wonderful job in giving us a very splendid start. And what I want to do is not to talk about Dhirubhai as a friend, because that simply reduces him to his limited category of relations with me. Rather, talk about him as a remarkable individual, because it's as a Dhirubhai, for me, is an individual who embodies a certain way of thinking, a scholarship of a particular kind. And having known him since 1959, long before he became simply DLS, when I was joined the Baroda University as a young lecturer and he had joined the sociology department, I followed him until about 2019, which was the last time I saw him at Sohar's place. Somebody whom I greatly admired and loved, he came and stayed with us here in Hull for 2.5 month scholarship. He was followed by Ninad, and I take great pride in the fact that he and I became great friends. And as Ashish said, his departure was a great shock to many of us. In a sense, it sapped one's will to live. Although slightly differently, it also intensified one's will to go on, because one has job to do that he would have done had he been alive. Now it falls on us to continue to do the job. Whatever one's feeling, whether it diminishes your desire to go on or increases your desire, it has that kind of impact. And very few individuals have that kind of impact, not just on a small coterie of people to whom they are related, but on a large body of human beings whose lives they touch at various points. In Dhirubhai's case, as a scholar, which is how I want to pay my tribute to him, as a scholar, what was unique to him? What distinguished him as a scholar, his approach to India, his approach to society? And I think what struck me about him is that he was one of the very, very few Indians who were rooted in his tradition, rooted in the experience that he was studying. This idea of being rootedness is, to me, unique to Dhirubhai. And I want to explore this just for 2 or 3 minutes that are left to me. You see, intellectuals can be and are of many different kinds. We all have, as an intellectual, to establish our relation to ourselves and to other societies and other countries. And as individuals, I begin by asking myself, what is my relation to myself? Who am I? And secondly, what is my relation to the other? What is that other? And there one can take many different positions. I can condemn what I have inherited and embrace what is different or new, or I can condemn what is new or offered to me, or I can try to pick up pieces from each and try to create a synthetic kind of concept, all kinds of combinations. In those responses open to us, Dhirubhai's approach was very particular and marks all his writings, which was one of rootedness. My culture, my society is one which made me what I am, which shaped me. I start with that. I criticize it. I might even reject it, but this is this society, these are the experiences which have shaped me, and I begin with those experiences. And there, I think, is his novelty. Because the questions he asks are all these questions formulated from his own experiences, not imported from outside. Not what Foucault or somebody else would have said, you then try to turn Foucault into a generalized category and apply them to India. You don't apply anything to India. You simply start with India and take his work on the caste system or on democracy. He doesn't ask how did India indigenize democracy? Because that's a very dangerous question. Because the moment you ask how did it indigenize democracy, you already have a notion of democracy which is independently of India. Dhirubhai instead said, here is a country which has developed a certain form of democracy. Various factors have played their part. What factors were they? Caste. What role did it play? How complex were their roles? And as a result of that interplay, what kind of system have we in India developed? So this kind of question, what kind of democracy has India developed, rather than how did we indigenize British or Western or any other form of democracy? And I was particularly struck by this when I asked him to read one of my books on Gandhi. And he commented on it extensively, the book I dedicated to him, along with two other friends. And he said, you know, there are several places where I feel that Gandhi is your interlocutor. You are not asking Gandhi his questions. You are asking Gandhi John Stuart Mill's questions, or Karl Marx's questions, not his questions. I said, how do I know what goes through his mind? What are his questions? He said, those which would have arisen to him in the course of thinking his thought. And in the process, I must say, working on Gandhi's fast, for example, which puzzled me a great deal. Why would a man fast? Why wasn't it a form of blackmail or putting moral pressure? What was his reasoning? What was the framework of thought within which Gandhi conceived of the fast, calling it non-violent coercion, or this is what Christ does to you from the cross? Within that framework, what did it mean to him? Not what did it mean to me or to Gandhi's critics? So in a very fascinating kind of way, Dhirubhai's influence spread out in many different directions. It influenced many people who were not directly either his students or colleagues. And I think in that context, I want to end by paying a great tribute to a very dear friend who taught us what it is, and if I were to be slightly philosophical here, what it is to be rooted, and at the same time, how to reach out to others and be universal. So this idea of starting with your own society and ending with your own society, but seeing your society not as some kind of eccentric creation, but one of the possible ranges of human possibility. So what I might call mediated universality. Indian democracy is one example. But it also shows in a strange kind of way how universals can be realized. So in those strange and fascinating kind of ways, this man made some great contributions, which I think have yet to be fully teased out and appreciated. I take this occasion to express my deepest sympathies to his family, Aisa Soha, to his daughter, to Nan, and to all of us who have once upon a time loved the man and work with him. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Parekh. Thank you very much. I now invite Rajni Bakshi to join our conversation and make her intervention. Rajni is an activist and writer, and she has known Dhirubhai for a long time. Rajni.
Thank you, Ravi. Namaskar, and such an it's at one level so good to see so many seniors and peers all together. How the moment we are in, as Ashish Das said, is in too many ways unbearable. But yes, I also echo the same sentiment that Ashishta has put forward so much more eloquently. I think also that what I have so many lessons I learned from Dhirubhai, actually, that it's not going to be possible to enumerate even a fraction of them. But I think this looking at life with a kind of engaged detachment, I think this may have been his greatest gift. And I must, maybe this is a good time to put on record that if I'm here today because of Dhirubhai and Ashishta, because they were witness to junoon back in the 80s when I thought that I should declass myself and go live in some village and try to make a tribal of myself. And it was both of them who said to me, both bluntly and humorously, ke ye kya pagalpan hai? तुम लोग वहां चले जाओगे तो मिडिल क्लास पे कौन काम करेगा, मिडिल क्लास मोबिलाइजेशन कौन करेगा? सो वो तो पता नहीं वेदर यू नो वन डिड दैट और नॉट, बट यस आई थिंक इट सर्टनली हेल्प्ड इनॉर्मसली the whole exercise of finding one's feet, not just politically, but almost metaphysically, because, you know, in the mid-80s, I was what? You know, late 20s, and very confused and very much struggling, and as well, I suppose most people do at that age. So the debt is unrepayable. Of course, the should go in some kind of chronological order, because I'm assuming that everybody here present knows, all of us know. So the organization was, or rather the process, it was a process, it was a community, not a project, not an organization, which we called Lokayan, of which Dhirubhai was a founding member along with Ashish Da, Rajni Kothari, and Giri Deshinkar. Vijay Pratap will talk to you more about the Lokayan legacy, but I just want to bring forth one detail here. You know, these days, many people ask me, especially younger people who now hear that once upon a time there was something called Lokayan dialogue of the people. Okay, how did you people do it? What was the process? You know, like, as though they think that we had some technology. Well, actually, I think the core energy in Lokayan was held together by Dhirubhai Sahajta. I don't have an English word for it. Which was, I would say, at least 80% humor. And it was a truly beautiful humor, because he was never laughing at anything, not a situation, not an ideology, certainly never a person. But he was so often visibly amused, you know, by the almost delightful ironies of life and the kind of complex multi-dimensionality in which you could see reality. And that, you know, I mean, if, as I said, if I have to pick one thing to share with you, that is his greatest gift to me personally, and I think to many of us. That, see, I certainly was brought up in the kind of intellectual culture where you were encouraged to enter a room and, you know, try to divide the people in the room as oppressors and oppressed. And if I have any journey in which I've tried to liberate myself from that kind of ridiculous binary, I think that I learned at Dhirubhai's feet. And so I'm just actually, his departure has only created a renewed sense of how blessed we were. I was telling Vijay this the other day that, you know, when we get depressed about where we are today as a society and as a country, I think it's because we had an extraordinary childhood, political childhood. And it's because of all of you. Ashish Da and Dhirubhai are the only ones, you know, who stayed with us through the whole ups and downs of that. And last but not least, on a personal note, I'm so happy to say that Vijay, Ritu, and Uma, Shankari, and I had the privilege of a long, laughter-filled afternoon with Dhirubhai over lunch at Soha's house very recently, I think like 2.5 years ago. And so I have the great satisfaction that I have something very happy to remember him by. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajni, for that beautiful intervention. Thank you. I will now invite Professor Ghanshyam Shah, well-known sociologist, very old friend of Dhirubhai, to make his intervention. Ghanshyam Bhai.
Well, I don't have a words to say about Dhirubhai, because personally I have lost a counsel. My relationship began way back to 1964-65, when the center was at a different location. And almost every evening, invariably, he and his bird, me and my wife Kalpana, used to meet after dinner for talking all kinds of things that is happening and also playing cards. And that kind of helped us. Later, when we moved to the Rajput Road, continually became a major feature of the center. And I had continued that privilege, talking at long hours on various things till 2017 or 18, when he visited, he and Subhiban visited Baroda. Because every winter they used to come to Baroda, and at least twice or thrice we used to go there, or he used to come here, and a long chat on all kinds of things. And I have never found at least an intellectual who was rooted in reality. I owe him on my own whatever I wrote, because often he warned me whenever I made a sweeping emotional generalizations and observations that made me to rethink about it and reformulate. And I know for sure that frequently he also used to change or modify his position, because he was never rigid, he was grounded in reality. When I moved from Delhi to Surat, initially he was not sure, and he warned me that it's very difficult to work with IP Desai, because IP was his teacher. But at the same time, he told me that perhaps you are the person who can really work with. And when I settled with IP after 3 years, actually, he was very happy. Because he was not just what Asis and Bhikkhu Bhai say, was not reflecting on day-to-day situation or intellectual ideas of self and others, but also always reflecting and giving input on various activities of the center. Lunch adda was not just abstract talk, but also a business. Way back in 1966, we began this previous avatar of Lokniti, election study, where Basi did a study on Kerala, and that continued. And during the last more than 25 years, I think, with Lokniti, I have always found his deep interest and always asking the uncomfortable questions, those who were involved in carrying out the research or formulating the questions. He was so grounded, and occasionally we had differences. And I recall in 2007 when he, Rajiv, Yogendra Yadav, Vibhi Singh, we were in a Saurashtra in Gujarat tree to study the elections. And one day morning we were in Bhavnagar, and we read the headline of Sonia Gandhi's statement telling Narendra Modi is a maut ka sadagar. And immediately Dhirubhai reflected that Congress would definitely lose. He's often soft Hindutva position. I have some differences, but I would now realize, in fact, I wanted to talk to him just a few days back, when Mamta won, and I thought that I will talk to him on Sunday. We used to talk occasionally, at least once in a month. And before I could do, he left us. Dhirubhai was just not intellectual friend in common, but was also a family member. He was counseling me on several personal issues over 60 years. And he was an extended member of our family. So not only me and Kalpana, but also children and our grandchildren remember him very fondly, him and Sugriva. And we will continue to remember him in years to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Ghanshyam Bhai, for that intervention. Thank you very much. I will now invite Professor Deepak Nair, well-known economist, chairman of the board of the center, to join us.
Thank you, Ravi. We have assembled here this evening on a sad occasion, the passing away of Dhirubhai. It is an enormous loss for the CSDS as an institution, and it creates a big void for the social sciences in India. However, this gathering of his colleagues, friends, and admirers is also for us to remember Dhirubhai as our tribute. I first met Dhirubhai in the mid-1980s, soon after moving to Delhi. Thus, I knew him long before I had any association with the CSDS. Over the past 35 years, we got to know each other reasonably well, not as closely as many of you knew him. Even though we lived in somewhat different worlds, we did meet often enough. Sadly, during the period that I have been associated with the CSDS, particularly in the past 5 years, we met rarely, essentially as his health turned frail. The study of polity and society in India were his passion. And in the CSDS intellectual tradition, he was skeptical of economics as a profession, for he did not understand why economists lived in a world of abstraction as if the real world or real people did not matter. He did recognize, however, that I was different, I was heterodox, I was unorthodox, I was not the usual economist. We had one more thing in common. Both of us grew up in Mufassil, India. I went to Hindi medium school, he went to Gujarati medium school. And that was a sort of bond. And we had many engaging conversations on economics. I think in one conversation which I recall, it sent him into peals of laughter. We were talking about economists, and I said to him that microeconomic theorists who write about the theory of the firm would be unable to recognize an entrepreneur or a manager if they saw one, just as microeconomic theorists who work on agriculture and model risk, investment, or savings would not be able to recognize a farmer when they saw one, let alone distinguish between a Rabi and a Kharif crop on the ground. And that was, in a sense, the beginnings of our conversations. In the time I have, I want to focus on just three dimensions of Dhirubhai: the old school academic, the institutional person, and the public intellectual. He was indeed the old school academic for whom publications, impact factors, citations did not matter. In some ways, he reminded me of two people I met in Calcutta before I moved to Delhi, Bhabatosh Datta and Deepak Banerjee, both of whom taught economics at Presidency College Calcutta for their lifetimes, mentoring undergraduates and imparting knowledge, but published little, although they were capable of doing very creative, original work. Now, Dhirubhai was similar in seeking to impart and to disseminate knowledge, but was different, A, because he did not teach at the CSTS, which Bhavatosh and Deepak Babu did, and B, because he did publish. Now, some believe that he wrote too little, yet he did write, he did publish. What he wrote and published articulated, I believe, an important voice and exercised significant influence on social sciences in India. And I'm sure many of you will speak about that. Dhirubhai was also the institutional person. He created what has blossomed and thrived even after he withdrew. In a sense, he was an institutional builder in the classical sense of the word. He made himself dispensable in everything he started, and yet it continued to flourish. He was, with Rajni and Asish, among the founding fathers of the CSTS, which has grown into a leading research institution in India, indeed elsewhere in the world, that works at the intersection of the social sciences. He started Lokayan to create and to foster a dialogue between activists and academics. It was a most original and unusual quest. He founded Lokniti to pioneer the idea of post-poll surveys, which have helped so many understand and analyze the processes and outcomes of political democracy in India. He was, I must say, he did always say that to me, less enthusiastic about the pre-poll surveys and the sophology that followed it. But in retrospect, it was a positive externality which grew out of, arose out of what he and his colleagues started. And then after a time, the media simply took over as elections became what they became. And it enabled CSDS and its work to reach citizens and society in election season. And the passions of India and citizens of India, whether politics, cricket, or Bollywood, took over. And many people know the CSDS by its pre-poll surveys. The public intellectual. Dhirubhai's engagement with and passionate belief in political democracy in India, which he saw as a participatory process, was incredible, yet real. He engaged both with theory and practice. He theorized not from abstractions or from stylized facts, but from the learning embedded in the Indian experience, his perception, his understanding of it. It was, I believe, about decolonizing minds and decolonizing knowledge, which continue to be so strongly influenced by Western intellectual traditions in India, even almost 75 years after independence. His practice went beyond learning from experience. It was about people's participation as citizens. Thus, people were not just passive subjects of study for their voting behavior, or indeed their engagement with politics. In his worldview, people were center stage as active citizens or political actors who made decisions that could, but often did not, shape their lives. It is this passion that Dhirubhai had, which I think was a very important factor underlying the outreach of the CSDS as a group of public intellectuals to citizens and to society. I am going to stay with your brief, Ravi, of not exceeding 5 minutes. In conclusion, I would just like to say a few words about Dhirubhai, the person that I knew. He was modest and unassuming, yet self-assured and confident. He had strong beliefs and convictions, yet open to engaging with opposite points of view. So there was in him the quintessential liberal intellectual tradition. He was remarkably egalitarian with everybody. He had a conscious dislike for hierarchies, and so it is no surprise that he was wonderful with young people, with young researchers, with young students, yet he would not suffer fools. He was, as Peter writes, Dhirubhai was not glamorous, but he was a man of substance in every sense of the word. And he was a concerned citizen of the Republic of India in every sense of the metaphor, in a real sense. Above all, he was a wonderful human being. Sadly, he was part of what is now a vanishing breed, an almost endangered species in the social sciences. We will all miss him. So will the CSDS. I think we should do everything we can to celebrate this remarkable life. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Nair. I now invite, and it is appropriate, after Professor Nair's comments, my colleague, political theorist, who edited this remarkable book, At Home with Democracy, which is a collection of Dhirubhai's writing. And Peter has written extensively on Dhirubhai, apart from many things. Peter.
Thank you, Ravi. I've written a long introduction to Dhirubhai's work. I've written two tributes to him, one in the APW, one in Scroll. So it doesn't make sense for me to repeat what I have said, and in a sense, continue the conversation that I've been having with his ideas over all these years. I thought I would do something different. I thought I would speak about some episodes that we shared, because Dhirubhai was my mentor. He was my friend. He was my advisor. He was somebody I enjoyed jousting with, bantering with, drinking with, traveling with. He was many things to me, and I thought, if I have to speak today, let me speak about a facet of Dhirubhai that charmed me so much. The Dhirubhai that that all of us knew and in a sense infected all of us. So as I was going through the various episodes that I wanted to narrate, I was wondering, should I tell you the story of the time Dhirubhai and I came back from a dialogue in Sri Lanka, came to the immigration counter in Delhi airport, when Dhirubhai shouted at the immigration officials because they were so disrespectful of the passengers who'd arrived? Or should I tell you about the time he and I tried to smuggle half a bottle of vodka into Karachi, thinking that we would be able to get through the customs? But I decided I'm going to use this occasion to tell you two small incidents of both Dhirubhai and Surabhi Ben, because for me, in the decades that I have known them, they go together. The first story comes from when Dhirubhai and I were traveling to Shimla. This was in the early years of my tenure in Shimla. My daughters had just given me a little puppy. They said I needed a puppy to keep me company in Shimla, a three-month-old Labrador. And I wasn't quite sure how to take the Labrador to Shimla. My daughters were traveling with me. We had booked to travel by train from New Delhi to Kalka. And Dhirubhai was traveling with us. So the previous evening before travel, somebody said, go to a vet and the vet will give you a sedative. You give the dog the sedative and the dog won't make any trouble. So we did that. We got a syrup, gave the dog two spoons. The vet had said, give one spoon. We gave two just to be on the safe side. Arrived at the station the next morning, Dhirubhai, my daughters and me. We were traveling by executive class. And I thought, you know, being sort of law abiding, I would go and ask the TT whether I could take the dog on board, the little puppy. So the TT said, no, not allowed by railway rules. You cannot take the dog on board. 10 minutes to go. Should we board the train? Should we abandon, we couldn't leave the dog behind. Should we go back home? Or should we travel with the dog and break the rules? So I decided we just travel with the dogs because my daughter started crying and that was persuasive enough for me to be a rule breaker. We got onto the train, Dhirubhai, my daughters and me. And fortunately, there are just three stations between New Delhi and so the train started off. The TT knew we had smuggled the dog on board, but he sort of with a wink and a nod sort of did not raise it. Sure enough, my little puppy Figo started barking in the coach. And all the children in the coach, suddenly you could hear them say, Mommy, there's a puppy on board. Can we see where it is? So the game was out. As the puppy started barking, Soli Swaraj got up. He was also on the same coach and walked down the aisle to see where the noise was coming from. So he saw Dhirubhai. He said, "Hi, Dhirubhai, how are you? Oh, you have a puppy on board. You can't, that's against the rules." All very playful, all sort of in light humor. And he went back to his seat. So I turned to Dhirubhai and I said, "Great, Soli Swarabji is here. So if ever we get arrested or punished by rules," he says, we can ask Soli to defend us. Dhirubhai said, "No." He says, "Soli is not going to defend you on breaking the rules. But what we can ask Soli is to defend the dog on animal rights. The railways can't throw the dog out." Now that was Dhirubhai. You know, he always saw a side, as Ashish said, that none of us could ever see. The second story also comes from Shimla. And this is when Dhirubhai and Surabhi Ben were there. Dhirubhai was a national scholar. They were staying in the national scholar's apartment. And the national scholar's apartment overlooked the valley. Very beautiful scenic view. And Surabhi Ben loved it. She used to sit out on the veranda and watch the clouds and go by and enjoy the rain and see the sunrise and the sunset. One Sunday when I was with her and Dhirubhai, we were having coffee in the morning, suddenly she heard the sound of the train, the hoot of the train. And she rushed out to the balcony. So I said, "What are you doing?" She said, "I just love to see the train go by four times a day. It reminds me of my childhood." That was Surabhi Ben for me, you know, a little girl who was always there. Why do I tell you these two stories? Because for me, that was the multifaceted relationship I had with them. As you know, towards the end, I was struggling with Dhirubhai to bring out his book. One day I came to the center very early. And I thought I must finish it because you know, time was running out. Both he and Surabhi Ben were in failing health. It was 9 o'clock in the morning. I reached the center very early when I got a call from him. And that call was haunting. He said, "Peter, she's gone." That sound showed me it's a haunting sound. It reminds me of what that relationship was, what it meant to them. And today, since we are remembering Dhirubhai, I want to remember Surabhi Ben as well, because for me, they're both gone today. And yet, it's their life that I want to celebrate. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you very much. I now want to invite Gurpreet Mahajan, a political scientist, former JNU professor, who has collaborated extensively with Dhirubhai. Gurpreet.
Thank you very much, particularly for including me in this gathering of scholars and your close community. and having an opportunity both to celebrate a life of a scholar, a friend, as well as to share and express my grief with everybody else, and perhaps in the process heal a little bit, if that is at all possible. And I want to start on a different note, perhaps, because I think one needs to recognize that reality. You know, Dhirubhai and I belong to different worlds institutionally. And if popular perceptions were to be believed, he was obviously from, as everyone knows, from the Center for the Study of Developing Societies, and I was from Center for Political Studies, JNU, which were in popular perception, you know, really standing at two extreme ends, or usually supposedly in conflict with each other and in opposition to each other. And yet, somewhere in the mid-90s, Dhirubhai organized a seminar on minorities at Shimla, at IIAS Shimla, and he invited me. And that, I think, was this enormous generosity. And retrospectively, I want to say a little bit more, because it also showed to me something that our mutual friend, his and my mutual friend, Professor Gopal Guru, always reminds me, that ideas come first. And perhaps that's what academic life and generosity of a person is really about, that ideas come first, then of course institutions and people and so on and so forth. But ideas really trump everything, and he most generously invited me. And that was really the first time we perhaps engaged with each other seriously and heard each other at length. I'm weak in spirit, so I rarely joined the Adda, so it was a short-lived experience and interaction. A couple of years after, I'm sure our paths crossed in between too. We met and conversation turned back to that seminar and what he's doing. And he said, Gurpreet, mere bas ka nahi, I want to publish it, par kya karu? And then he turned to me and simply said, out of the blue, he said, tum karo. I said, don't, this was your seminar, you must do it yourself. And he said, nahi, tum mere saath karo. And we had no academic collaboration before, no long discussion. And I think one of those rare and moments where spontaneous and rash decisions, especially when you're not on the Twitter, always work well. We never negotiated. We didn't say, what is your idea on this subject and my idea? How will we plan? Whose name will come first and whose will be second? None of this mattered. And it was such a smooth, it worked like a breeze. He said, asked me to write the introduction. I wrote, sent it to him, and we found gradually a starting point where we were thinking in terms of the idea of minority, both in the same sort of way, but him is much more richer in experience from Asia, from India and South Asia as a whole. And the basic idea was that we didn't want to think of minorities merely in number term. I just mentioned this because I think that's the kind of person he was, and that's what he means. When we are talking about his work and celebrating his life, I think it's not just the spoken word and the written word, it's the conduct of life. And to me, that was really the starting point of our relationship, the generosity that emanated from sheer respect and desire to engage with ideas, share them, give them a public presence, and perhaps even differ on them, even if you are collaborators together. So that's the sort of person he was. And I shall remember, this is one of the things I have learned from him, that it takes so little to be not trapped in mythologies, and to give priority to a life of the mind that he was so much engaged in, and that we wished also to be engaged in. But I also don't want to leave it at that, at only personal level. I want to extend that personal level of interaction to say that actually we collaborated subsequently, and despite a frequent phrase that you know, lament we have heard, that Dhirubhai used to be rather reluctant to put down his ideas in writing. In 2008 or 9, he wrote a chapter for a book that Professor Surinder Jutka and I published on religion and development. So, and it was easy and it worked. And I think this was just a commitment to that academic way of life. And I think that's the lesson I want to, or the thought I want to carry forward with me, at this time. But I must also say that as far as written work is concerned, there is so much that has already been said about his larger perspective. But Dhirubhai had a way of using concepts and language which was unique and compelling, and also created distinctions which we sometimes gloss over. And I want to draw attention to just two or three of them, which really touch upon our shared interests and academic and intellectual interests. One was on the idea of identity politics. And most often when we talk about identity politics, we juxtapose it to liberal secular politics. And he also agreed that there is a distinction to be made there, and there is an erosion of the liberal secular ethos when we are thinking about identity politics. But I think what was so striking about his intervention was that he said, you know, we can't stop there. There are different kinds of identity politics. Some identity politics, he thought, was democratizing, other was not. And actually, he was making a distinction between caste-based identity politics and religion-based identity politics. The first, which was, as it were, extending the claims of social justice and rights, but most importantly, it was decentralizing, it was heterogenizing, it brought about plurality. But when it came to religion-based identity politics, it made me think that it is different because it is homogenizing and it has a pan-nation kind of framework. And I thought there's an interesting distinction that one needed to think about. I sometimes think that agreement is perhaps overrated. We don't need so much agreement in academic world. When somebody makes you think about an idea, that's so important. And I think that's what Dhirubhai made me do. Then again, when I was, and occasionally I returned back to this work on civil society, he rarely used the word civil society. It was most often non-governmental organizations, voluntary sector. And the distinction he made along with Harsh on the pre-1990 period and the post-1990 period. And I think there's such a striking difference because he thought of the earlier phase of NGO activity being linked, not just linked, but emanating out of a long drawn mobilization and interaction at the grassroots level. And post-1990s, he represented that phase as the emergence of a new group, professionals, ex-bureaucrats, middle classes, which are carrying forward this work of building the link between state and society. But I think the interesting thing was to think, which he wanted us to think about, that they really impact democracy differently and perhaps touch upon build capabilities of a different kind when it comes to citizenship. And I remember that idea and I haven't thought about it enough, but that's something I would like to return to over and over again. And then there was this idea that he had, which he referred to as democratic structural autonomy from modernity. And this is how he described India. That here, when we think in terms of modernity and democracy in Western society, which is what he had in mind with modernity, we always think in terms of centrality of the individual. We think in terms of autonomy of the individual and therefore individual-based rights. That's very central to that notion of modernity. And we thought that maybe in India, people were saying that, you know, when we are thinking about India, democracy has a different framework. It is something which moves away from the individual because articulation of demands invariably brings in the collective dimension. So people enter as collectivity. So identities will come in. But as you enter into the electoral process, there is bound to be decentralization, if not also fragmentation of that collectivity and a different kind of group and subgroup, and within that the individual is likely to emerge. And again, I thought this is such an interesting way of thinking in terms of, I think, the kind of thing people had in mind, that we think about what is the process by which the same element of modernity or democracy is really working out in India. I think there are so many other elements I could talk about. There's an idea which I'm very sympathetic to and found very little resonance in India with others, but he put it across in a different framework to talk about the distinction between pluralism and secularism, where his framework, of course, he was coming from a different perspective, but his framework really was that our response to religion-based mobilizations, majoritarian mobilizations, has not been in terms of liberal, secular conceptual categories, rule of law, freedom, right to speech and expression, and stuff like this. It has been in terms of evoking notions of pluralism.
I don't have time really to go on about it, but I'm just saying these are just illustrations that in just one or two spheres of his work and writing, which I had occasion to engage with more closely and think about, he left me with so many ideas really to think about. And that's the hallmark of, I think, a great mind, a scholar, a person who touches upon your life and your mind so deeply. I am amongst not those fortunate ones who can say I've led the life without regret, and it will always be my regret that I did not make sufficient effort to continue these conversations. My excuse, of course, then was that it was occasionally a strain for him to speak, and especially in the last 2-3 years, and I used that. I was therefore reluctant, and last time I met Ashita, and he said, he and Uma go to visit him once a month and have a meet with him. And I was very inclined to say, take me along, but what can one say, constraints of that civilization has placed on us, and I didn't, and it shall remain always my regret that I lost all those many opportunities to learn from him, to have those conversations, and really to have an occasion to meet a very dear friend and scholar. So,
Thank you, Gurpreet, and thank you very much for that intervention. I now call on Yugendra Yadav, who's an activist, political thinker, one of the founders of Lokneeti, whose collaboration with Ruba is very, very close. Yugen.
Shukriya, Ravi. Kahi baatein jo kahi jaani chahiye thi, wo kahi ja chuki hain. पीटर ने बहुत अच्छा लिखा है, ईपीडब्ल्यू में भी, स्क्रॉल में, मैंने भी प्रिंट में कुछ लिखा है, धीरूभाई को क्यों एक मॉडर्निटी के थिंकर के रूप में समझा जाना चाहिए. तो वो सब बातें मैं दोहराना नहीं चाहता, मैं एक कहानी सुनाना चाहता हूँ. कहानी धीरूभाई की नहीं है, लेकिन धीरूभाई को समझने के लिए जरूरी है. कहानी है एक बारात की, नॉर्थ इंडियन बारात की, जिसमें पुराने जमानों की तरह लड़की वाले एक शर्त रखते हैं. कहते हैं बारात में जितने मर्जी लोगों को ले आओ, लेकिन कोई बूढ़ा नहीं होना चाहिए, सब काले बाल वाले. अब लड़के वालों को शक हो गया, तो उन्होंने कहा ठीक है मान लेते हैं, लेकिन अपने साथ ट्रंक में, शायद बारात में जाते हुए ट्रंक में अपने साथ एक बूढ़े को ले गए. बारात पहुंची और लड़की वालों ने शर्त रखी कि ठीक है शादी तो हो जाएगी, लड़की भेज देंगे, लेकिन तभी जब तुम 40 लोग जो बारात में आए हो वो 40 बकरे खा के जाओ. अब हड़कंप मच गया, सब मिथिकल स्टोरीज है, हड़कंप मच गया, साहब क्या करें, 40 बकरे हम लोग कैसे खाएं, और ये तो कंडीशन लगा दी. फिर वो चुपचाप से ट्रंक में बैठे उस बुजुर्ग के पास जाते हैं, कहते हैं बाबा क्या करें, ये तो कह रहे हैं कि 40 लोगों को 40 बकरे खाने पड़ेंगे. उसने कहा तुम हाँ कर दो, कहो हाँ करेंगे, बस एक वक्त पे एक बकरा कटेगा, एक बकरा खत्म हो जाएगा, फिर दूसरा बकरा कटेगा, फिर तीसरा बकरा कटेगा, फिर चौथा बकरा कटेगा. और इस लेजेंड के हिसाब से 40 बकरे कटे भी, खाए भी गए, और वो लोग शादी करके वापिस आ गए. ये कहानी मैं क्यों कह रहा हूं, मेरे हिसाब से वो ट्रंक में बैठा हुआ बुजुर्ग धीरूभाई शेठ थे. अगर मुझे कभी भी कहा जाए कि ऐसी बारात में एक इंसान को लेके जाना है, एक बुजुर्ग को लेके जाना है, तो वो डीएल शेठ थे. अगर वो बारात हिंदुस्तान की जर्नी है पिछले 70 साल की, तो डीएल शेठ वो बुजुर्ग थे जो कि आपको एन मौके पे अलर्ट कर सकते हैं, वार्न कर सकते हैं, एनकरेज कर सकते हैं, ठीक डायरेक्शन में मोड़ सकते हैं. विजडम जो हमारी एकेडमिक इंडस्ट्री में बहुत खत्म हो गई है. धीरूभाई में मुझे ना वो वर्बल जगलरी नजर आती थी, कोई आपको बहुत क्लेवर थे लेकिन अपनी क्लेवरनेस डेमोन्स्ट्रेट करने का कोई आग्रह नहीं था. सही बात कैसे कही जाए, ये बात धीरूभाई ने सिखाई. और सही बात डोमिनेंट आइडियोलॉजीज के सामने, डोमिनेंट फ्रेमवर्क्स के सामने, वो वेस्ट के ही नहीं, कॉलोनियल के बारे में तो कई बातें हुई, डीकोलोनाइज करने का उन्होंने किया, मगर अपने यहाँ के तमाम तरह की आइडियोलॉजिकल ऑर्थोडॉक्सीज के सामने खड़े होके कैसे हिम्मत से अपनी बात कही जाए. मैं समझता हूं हमें दर्ज करना चाहिए कि सेकुलरिज्म का इस देश में जो हाल आज हो गया है, उसके बारे में हमें वार्न और अलर्ट करने वाले सबसे पहले लोगों में से धीरूभाई शेठ. उनकी भाषा कई बार बहुत शार्प होती थी, लेकिन उन्होंने हमें अलर्ट किया. नेशनलिज्म को नेग्लेक्ट करने का और नेशनलिज्म का माहौल बनाने का क्या होगा हश्र,
ये बात कहने वाले पहले लोगों में से धीरूभाई शेठ थे। कास्ट रिजर्वेशंस पे धीरूभाई को वैसे शौक नहीं था स्टेटमेंट साइन करना और कहना मेरी ये पोजीशन है, लेकिन उस वक्त हिम्मत से कास्ट रिजर्वेशंस के पक्ष में खड़े होकर बोलना धीरूभाई शेठ ने किया। कई बार झलाट भी होती थी, कई चीजें हैं जिसके बारे में रिग्रेट भी रहता था। जैसे मुझे हमेशा लगता था धीरूभाई आप और ज्यादा क्यों नहीं लिखते, क्योंकि मुझे कई बार लगता था कि उनकी हर हर लाइन में एक आर्टिकल है। धीरूभाई अपने पुराने आर्टिकल्स की रीराइटिंग करते वक्त एक नया आर्टिकल लिखते रहते थे और मैं उनसे झल्लाता था कि सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट बात अपने आर्टिकल की आपने पेज नंबर 12 के पैराग्राफ नंबर 3 में क्यों लिख रखी है, उसको आप सबसे आगे क्यों नहीं लिखते। सेल्फ प्रेजेंटेशन धीरूभाई को इंटरेस्ट उनको कहीं नहीं था। सेल्फ प्रेजेंटेशन, मेरे आर्टिकल को ये इम्पैक्ट होगा, इतने लोगों ने पढ़ा, कोई इंटरेस्ट नहीं था। इसके बारे में कई बार झल्लाट रहती थी, रिग्रेट रहता था कि वो टीचर क्यों नहीं थे धीरूभाई। हम जैसे इनफॉर्मल स्टूडेंट्स उनके बहुत थे, लेकिन अगर पढ़ाते किसी यूनिवर्सिटी में सैकड़ों लोग उनके एक एक सेंटेंस को शायद एक एक डिसर्टेशन में बदलते, एक एक किताब में बदलते, आर्टिकल में बदलते। मेरी जिंदगी में धीरूभाई का बहुत बड़ा महत्व रहा, चूंकि मेरे सेंटर के आने के पीछे धीरूभाई का आमंत्रण था, उनका आग्रह था। मेरे सेंटर में टिकने के पीछे धीरूभाई का सहयोग था और मेरे सेंटर जाते वक्त धीरूभाई का आशीर्वाद था। जैसे रजनी बख्शी ने बताया कि उनको आदिवासी लाइफ लीड करने से धीरूभाई ने बचाया, मुझे भी, मैं 1993 में सोच रहा था यूनिवर्सिटी की नौकरी छोड़ के अपने गाँव जाऊँगा, वहीं रहूँगा। तो जिन कई लोगों को आदिवासी या गांव वाला बनने से बचाया, मैं भी उनमें से एक था। धीरूभाई ने मेरे से बात की, डिसवेडेड मी और कहा कि सीएसडीएस आ जाओ, कहाँ तुम जा रहे हो गांव में अपने। मैं नहीं जानता अच्छा था बुरा था, लेकिन धीरूभाई ने ये किया। उनके चलते मैं सीएसडीएस आया। यहाँ वीबी सिंह हैं श्रोताओं में, सुहास पलशिकर हैं, संदीप शास्त्री हैं, संजय जी हैं, हम सब जानते हैं लोक नीति बना और खड़ा हुआ धीरूभाई की वजह से। शुरू में मैं जानता हूं पॉलिटिकल थ्योरी करते वक्त साथ में इलेक्शन सर्वे करने का कितना मखौल उड़ता था, अरे क्या कर रहे हो, तुम्हें क्या हो गया, अच्छे खासे पॉलिटिकल थ्योरीज थे, किन चक्कर में फंस गए हो। अगर धीरूभाई का सपोर्ट ना होता तो शायद हम खींच खा के थक के छोड़ देते सर्वेज करना, सर्वे रिसर्च करना, लेकिन धीरूभाई का सपोर्ट था कि नहीं सबसे गहरी थ्योरी इसमें से निकलेगी। शायद हम वो निकाल नहीं पाए, लेकिन वो सहारा धीरूभाई का था। और जैसे मैंने कहा कि CSDS से जाते वक्त धीरूभाई ने कहा तो नहीं कि जाओ छोड़ जाओ, लेकिन मैं उनसे पूछने गया कि बस अब मेरी इच्छा है छोड़ने की, अब मेरी इच्छा है राजनीति करने की। वो जानते थे, क्योंकि जैसा कई साथियों ने बताया मेरे पर्सनल जिंदगी में भी बहुत इंटरेस्ट लेते थे, वो जानते थे मैं जिंदगी में करना क्या चाहता हूँ। उन्होंने ना नहीं की, उन्होंने बस इतना कहा कि लिखना मत छोड़ना, कीप राइटिंग, और आशीर्वाद दिया। मेरी बहुत इच्छा थी कि धीरूभाई को कभी बता सकूं हाउ मच ही मेंट टू मी। आज एक बहुत अच्छी बात हुई है कि हम में से कई लोगों ने सुरभि बेन को याद किया। शायद मेरी बात सुनकर सुहा को अजीब लगेगा, सुहा योर मदर वॉज वन ऑफ द फाइनेस्ट ह्यूमन बींग्स आई मेट इन माई लाइफ। मैं कभी कह नहीं पाया उन्हें, कभी इंसान के तौर पे और एक स्कॉलर के तौर पे मेरी इच्छा रही कि उनसे कुछ ज्यादा सीख सकते, उनको हमने याद किया। मेरी इच्छा रहती थी कि धीरूभाई को कभी कह सकूं, मगर उनकी कुछ ऐसी पर्सनैलिटी थी कि उनके पास जाओ और जाके आप ना तो ये कह सकते थे और ना कभी उनका पांव छू सकते थे, क्योंकि कहीं एक वो एक इगेलिटेरियनिज्म था ना, वो रास्ते में आ जाता था, नहीं धीरूभाई के साथ आप ये कर नहीं सकते। पिछले साल जब मैं अपनी किताब लेके उनके पास गया सोहा के घर गुड़गांव में, मैंने हिम्मत करके उनके पांव छुए, इस बार उन्होंने ना नहीं की। नमस्कार।
थैंक यू वेरी मच। But I now invite Vijay Pratap. Vijay Pratap, old activist, comrade of Dhirubhai from the Lokayan days, to join us. Vijay.
CSTS के सभी लोगों और रवि सुंदरम का धन्यवाद, आपने इतने महत्वपूर्ण लोगों के साथ मुझे भी श्रद्धांजलि अर्पित करने का मौका दिया। मेरे लोकायन के कुछ दोस्त हैं जिनको हिंदी में दिक्कत होगी, और मैं मूलतः लोकायन की अपनी पहचान के बतौर अपनी श्रद्धांजलि अर्पित करना चाह रहा हूँ। तो अंग्रेजी बहुत अच्छी ना जानते हुए भी मैं अंग्रेजी में अपनी बात कहने की कोशिश करूँगा। लोकायन मेरी समझ से पीटर ने जैसे लिखा उनको उद्धृत करते हुए कि इंडिया ने पोस्ट मॉडर्निज्म से ही शुरू किया, तो मुझे लगता है कि लोकायन एक तरह का पोस्ट मॉडर्निज्म का फिनोमिनन था जो आइडियोलॉजिकल फ्रेमवर्क से ऊपर उठ के मल्टी लेयर्ड कॉम्प्लेक्स मल्टी डायमेंशनल नैरेटिव इट क्रिएटेड एंड दिस बिकेम सो पावरफुल नैरेटिव दैट ऑन द लेफ्ट पीपल लाइक प्रकाश करत एंड माय पॉलिटिकल गुरु इन द सोशलिस्ट मूवमेंट किशन पटनायक रोट लॉन्ग क्रिटिक ऑफ लोकायन एज वेल एज ऑफ द फंडिंग। सो दिस आई एम रिकॉलिंग नॉट टू क्रिटिसाइज एनीवन बट जस्ट टू से द काइंड ऑफ इम्पैक्ट इट क्रिएटेड एट दैट टाइम। इट हैड 9 चैप्टर्स एंड इट हैड वेरी वेरिड काइंड ऑफ पीपल इन्वॉल्व इन इट एंड दिस वॉज ऑल धीरूभाई मेकिंग। It started as a foreign-funded project at CSDS. The first meeting was held on 16th May 1980. And the way Dhirubhai gave space to all kinds of contrary-looking trends and personalities is amazing. And everyone he chose had something unique to contribute, but everyone felt that they were the Lokayan. This is the kind of his way of conveying an idea was very non-threatening. The Andhra co-convener of Lokayan, founder co-convener Dr. Uma Shankari had put in that he was always learning, and in his learning, it was always in a framework of mutual learning, and the other person, without feeling threatened, will learn what Dhirubhai had to say or to communicate. In the initial period, the project was written as Development, Democracy and Decentralization, but as Rajni Bakshi said, it became a process. I would say it was not a process, it was multi-processes around very strong individuals. In 1985, when we got the Right Livelihood Award, I was on a paternity leave. The editor, I had no access to documents. I wrote editorial from home, Lokayan Bulletin's editorial. So I had acknowledged 84 persons, you know, people like Devdutt, Datta Savle, from Bihar movement, persons like Manimala, Raghupati. So I shouldn't name all the 84 people, but persons like Gorepati Narendranath of Andhra, Manoharan of Tamil Nadu, Claude Alvarez, Norma Alvarez, Vanna Shiva, Jayant Bandopadhyay from Karnataka. So all these people were not brought in by Dhirubhai necessarily, but the way they could sustain and own Lokayan process, it was because of Dhirubhai Sheth. And some of the, if I recall the initial conceiving phase, it was quite long. January 1980 we started, and we had our first meeting on 16th May 80. In that conceptualization, there was Ramashri Rai, Professor Giri Deshinkar, Professor Ashish Nandi, all used to contribute in the discussions on the roadmap. And it was months of discussion that roadmap was chalked out. And from the activist circle, I was representing at that time, no one else had been recruited from the activist side. But as soon as the process took off, in November 1981, we had the first national convention. And in that, I was asked to give the keynote. So what I'm saying is, in all the 9 chapters, activists were leading the process, and I have yet to come to see a person or an outfit where activists and intellectuals participate at an equal footing. And he was able to sustain this community of workers along with giant intellectuals like Ashish Nandi, like Ramashri Rai, because he himself was keeping himself in a self-effacing mode. As I said, in 85, when we got the award, Right Livelihood, it's bestowed on 9th of December, one day before Nobel Prize in Stockholm, in the Swedish parliament. So Dhirubhai should have been the natural choice to go and receive, but it was Rajni Kothari and Vijay Pratap who went and received the award. So the usual tension or usual barriers you see between activists and intellectuals was not there in Lokayan, and everybody was in co-production of knowledge on an equal footing. When Dhirubhai withdrew, we could not sustain Lokayan as it was under his leadership. He was a Nepathya Nayak, person driving us, inspiring us, teaching us how to go about it while not taking the front seat. And he was primarily able to do it because he believed in the intrinsic worthwhileness of the wholeness, in which he saw himself as one partial component, and each component was critical to it. And each person he brought up, he made the framework of Lokayan in a manner that each, what Smitu Kothari contributed, Vijay Pratap could not have. What Vijay Pratap contributed, Claude Alvarez could not have. What Vandana Shiva contributed, and she was one with Jayant Bandyopadhyay, they were one of the first to talk about the new, other than class disparities, how access to natural resource is a structural issue. And after that, this politics of natural resource politics became, now it's a common sense in the activist circle. So whole lot of like displacement, B.D. Sharma, Medha Patkar, Smitu Kothari, they worked on displacement issues of Narmada Valley, as well as with Suresh Sharma and Avdesh on Singrauli. A book was brought out, which is first of critique on development model, Vikas Ki Kimat. So there were so many exceptional things which were done by different people in Lokayan, like science and technology critique under the leadership of Ashish Nandi with PPST group. And this was possible because Dhirubhai was able to recognize the truth of the other person and respect it and listen to it. And his listening capacity made him a great teacher also, because he was able to learn what most of us were not able to learn. Our attitude to Lokayan was more like some kind of means to an end. Lokayan itself was not the larger end in itself, but for Dhirubhai, Lokayan was end in itself, the creation of that kind of narrative, and that is what he expected from us. Unfortunately, we could not fulfill his expectation. And when he withdrew, then most of us withdrew to our respective projects in life and gave up the project called Lokayan. So now I don't know, like we say, we'll to carry on the legacy, we have to do this, we have to do that. So honestly, I feel, the activist friends I am part of do not have the capacity to inspire and bring together intellectuals and a community of intellectuals and activists together, which will Lokayan like organizations are still needed in this polarized atmosphere where we have to engage with the other. And Dhirubhai was one person who I don't agree with Ghanshyam Bhai's sentence in passing, that he, if I understood correctly, that he believed in some kind of soft Hinduism. He, as Yogen said, he warned us of the way secular discourse is proceeding, the way we ridicule nationalism, but he wanted to engage with the other. And we had, after mosque demolition, we had a meeting with the RSS leaders like Govindachari and his other senior colleagues. So he was not scared of talking to any of the ideological streams, Marxist, Marxist-Leninist, Gandhian, socialist, independent issue-based organizations. They were all part of Lokayan and they all learned a great deal from him. And Dhirubhai's personality created that adhesive force which made us into a community. Now, I don't know if some younger, newer person can create that kind of adhesive force for us or not. Thank you. I pay my homage to Dhirubhai and Surbhi Ben both. And as Ghanshyam Bhai and Peter had said, they were guardians to both of us, Ritu and me. My guardian from the very beginning and Ritu after we met in 82. So their home was a place of solace and guidance for us. And we both will remain indebted to him and to Surbhi Ben for that guardianship. And I stop here.
Thank you, Vijayji, for your intervention. I now invite my colleague Rajiv Bhargav, political theorist, to make his intervention. Rajiv.
So this is a personal tribute, and I'll talk more about myself and Dhirubhai, our relationship. So I spoke to Dhirubhai about 10 days before he left all of us. Actually, I'd called Sloha to inquire about his health, but within minutes, she passed the mobile to him. His malfunctioning lungs forced him to speak haltingly, every word interrupted by short, heavy breaths. But his mind was alert, curious, clear as Himalayan spring water. In one previous conversation, early in the first wave, I tried to out Dhirubhai, Dhirubhai. The pandemic had given new life to Brahmanism, Dhirubhai, I said with humor and irony. This neo-Brahmanism is colonizing the globe. Everyone is expected to obsessively wash their hands, keep safe distance, and treat all others as quote-unquote untouchables. Dhirubhai burst into whatever laughter he could manage. This time, however, we spoke as sober social scientists, bemoaning that the actual figures were likely to be higher, and so on and so forth. Ineluctably, we were drawn to speak about the center. He had a question about something that had happened during the last few months of my tenure as a director. I had not realized that he was carrying a lingering feeling of a little bit of hurt at my annoyed response to an issue raised at that time. 8 years later, though reluctantly and lightheartedly, I found him uncharacteristically seeking an explanation. Clearly, enforced solitude had provided ample opportunity for reflection on personal matters. To his serious question, my answer was straight from the heart. It was all theater, Dhirubhai, I said. I wish to tell you through my newfound loud banter that you should have been more outraged at what had happened and given me stronger support. But my admiration and affection for you was undiminished then and remains so now, I added. Every bit of the statement was sincere and true. We were not mere colleagues, but personal friends. Some of you may not know that in 2003, when well before I formally joined the center, Tani, my lifelong companion, was battling death in Istanbul, undergoing a 6-hour-long open brain surgery to fix an aneurysm. And he was the only known person by my side. At night, shaken further by what the surgeon told me, I must have looked benumbed. Dhirubhai, who had been with me all along, watched me and asked solemnly if I wanted a drink. I did not refuse. He took out the bottle. We raised a toast to Tani and drank, partly as ritual, in part to induce sleep, but also to reaffirm our bond. Early next morning, he accompanied me to the hospital and left for his own presentation at the workshop, which we were attending, only after learning that Tani's post-surgery recovery had begun well. So Dhirubhai's departure is a big personal blow to both me and Tani. But that is insignificant compared to the loss to the wider intellectual world. For Dhirubhai was an unusual public intellectual, always learning about and transmitting local knowledges. His monumental intellectual presence is found less in his own writings and more in those of others. I find his original thoughts and weighty speculations embedded in the books of famous international scholars who had visited the center in search of native information, but had returned home enriched by his stunning theoretical insights. A personal meeting with him was always important, for Dhirubhai was a philosopher in the mold of the ancients, a lover of wisdom, at his best in personal dialogue and conversation. He spoke sage-like in aphorisms, leaving it to others to write and take his thoughts further. I know of thinkers who are analytical, who break things down to their constituents, but can't really put them back together. I know others who are good at making connections, but have no idea of the precise nature of what they have put together. Dhirubhai had the unusual ability to do both, to dissect and to connect. Exercising these skills came to him intuitively, as if by impulse. And these imaginative insights, defying limitations of space and time, cutting across disciplinary boundaries, could be about anything, about the ancients and the modern, about art or contemporary politics, about elite Sanskrit texts, about which I'm sure he must have learned a lot from Surabhi Ben, or popular culture. About 10 years ago, after my first cataract surgery, I told Dhirubhai that during the operation, I had the most amazing kaleidoscopic experience. I'd seen colors never seen in real life. Every shade of blue, red, green, yellow, vivid, resplendent, ever so fresh. I was ecstatic, I said. Dhirubhai asked me if I'd seen B. Shantaram's Navarang. You know, Rajiv, Shantaram's inspiration to make that film after his cataract surgery. I thought Dhirubhai was pulling a fast one. Next morning, I checked with Kumar Shani, who confirmed that this was true. Dhirubhai was not just imaginative, wise, and theoretical. He had the knack without moving an inch from the center's premises. I know he traveled a lot, but he also stayed in the center quite a lot. He had a knack of receiving information and permanently storing it inside his fertile brain. He was a living archive. There was barely anything relevant or interesting about which he had not heard, on which he did not have something intelligent to say. We had our differences, our disagreements, that occasionally went very, very deep, but we never quarreled. No ill will, no grudges, no walls. Sometimes one felt that he had overstated his case not as a ruse, but with conviction. But days later, one spotted the grain of truth in it. The sparkling pearl was hidden under a lot of mush. No one can step into his shoes, but I've recently stepped into his small room. And as I sit in that magical chair where he rested, slept, or slipped into deep thought, I shall unfailingly seek inspiration. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you very much for that beautiful intervention. I now call on my colleague, Abhay Kumar Dubey, who is a prominent writer, the director of the language program at CSDS, to make his intervention. Abhay, you need to unmute yourself, Abhay. Abhay, we can't hear you. You need to unmute yourself.
आज दिन में कई बार मैंने सोचा कि मैं 5 मिनट के अंदर धीरूभाई शेठ को कैसे श्रद्धांजलि दे सकता हूँ। तो मैं इस नतीजे पर पहुँचा कि मैं उनके बारे में एक ऐसी बात आप लोगों के साथ साझा करूँगा जो कोई नहीं जानता, सिर्फ मैं ही जानता हूँ। और वो बात आप लोगों को थोड़ी अजीब लग सकती है, लेकिन वो बात है बहुत ज़रूरी, उसका कहा जाना आज बहुत ज़रूरी है। वो बात यह है कि धीरूभाई केवल पॉलिटिकल सोशियोलॉजिस्ट नहीं थे, मैं उन्हें एक उपन्यासकार के रूप में जानता हूँ। धीरूभाई नॉवलिस्ट भी थे और उन्होंने एक नहीं बल्कि 2 नॉवेल लिखे। साहित्यकारों के बीच में एक फिक्रा प्रचलित है, हर आदमी की जिंदगी में एक उपन्यास तो होता ही है, और उपन्यासकार वो बनता है जो अपनी कल्पनाशीलता के सहारे, अपने इमेजिनेशन के सहारे दूसरा उपन्यास भी लिख सके। तो धीरूभाई ने चूंकि 2 उपन्यास लिखे थे, इसलिए मैं उन्हें बाकायदा एक उपन्यासकार मानता हूं। एक ऐसा उपन्यासकार जो कि समाज विज्ञान के अनुशासनों के परे जाकर उसने कल्पना की और 2 उपन्यास ऐसे लिखे जो जीवित उपन्यास हैं, जिनके कई पात्र इस मीटिंग में भी शामिल हैं। ये जो श्रद्धांजलि सभा हो रही है, उनके 2 उपन्यासों के पात्र इस सभा में भी शामिल हैं। उनके पहले उपन्यास का नाम था लोकायन और दूसरे उपन्यास का शीर्षक है भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम, इंडियन लैंग्वेजेस प्रोग्राम। सोशल साइंस का कोई भी अनुशासन, कोई भी थ्योरी और कोई भी प्रोटोकॉल, कोई भी संहिता ऐसी नहीं है जो इस तरह के अनुसंधान कार्यक्रमों को स्थापित करने की, सोचने की या कल्पित करने की गुंजाइश देती है। तो केवल जिसके पास एक औपन्यासिक कल्पनाशीलता होगी, इसके पास एक वैसी रचनाशीलता होगी, वही इस तरह के कार्यक्रम बना पाएगा। आप हिंदुस्तान में बहुत सारे रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट हैं, ICSR बहुत से रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट को ग्रांट देती है, लोग विदेशों से भी ग्रांट ले आते हैं, लेकिन किसी भी रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट में आपको ना लोकायन मिलेगा ना भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम मिलेगा। और लोकायन और भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम में फर्क केवल इतना है कि लोकायन धीरूभाई ने लिखना शुरू किया था, उसके पास उनका एक प्लॉट था, लेकिन उन्हीं की जिंदगी में वो उपन्यास का क्लाइमैक्स पूरा हो गया और उसके पात्र तितर बितर हो गए। भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम के बारे में उन्होंने, जब भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम की शुरुआत हुई उससे 10 साल पहले उन्होंने उसके बारे में, या 12-15 साल पहले उन्होंने उसके बारे में सोचना शुरू किया था। जब वो CSDS फैकल्टी के सदस्य नहीं रह गए और रिटायर हो गए, तब भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम शीर्षक का उपन्यास का लेखन शुरू हो पाया। और ये बात मैं इसलिए कह सकता हूं कि मैं खुद उस उपन्यास का एक पात्र हूं, और CSDS में बहुत से पात्र हैं जो अभी भी उस उपन्यास में धीरूभाई द्वारा निर्देशित गतिविधियों में लगे हुए हैं। धीरूभाई का इंडिया भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम के बारे में एक प्लॉट था, एक बहुत ही जटिल प्लॉट था। इस प्लॉट की शुरुआत जैसे हमेशा से होती है, 19वीं सदी के तमाम यथार्थवादी उपन्यासों की शुरुआत इस तरह से होती है कि आप नहीं जान सकते कि वो आगे किस दिशा में जाएंगे, चाहे वो चार्ल्स डिकेंस के उपन्यास हो या एम एल जोला के उपन्यास हो। धीरूभाई ने बिल्कुल उसी अंदाज में भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम नामक उपन्यास की शुरुआत की। जब मैं शुरू में उनसे 3-3, 4-4 घंटे बात करता था, ये सन 2000 की बात बता रहा हूं, तो पूरी बातचीत में 2-3 घंटे CSDS में बात होती थी। फिर जब मैं, मेरे साथ वो कार में सफर करते हुए सहविकास तक जाते थे, वहां रास्ते भर बातचीत होती थी करीब 45 मिनट, और हम लोग, मैं किसी नतीजे पर नहीं पहुंच पाता था कि इस भारतीय भाषा कार्यक्रम में मैं करूंगा क्या। तो पहले 3 साल इस कार्यक्रम में मैं इसलिए टिक पाया क्योंकि धीरू भाई से बातचीत होती थी। धीरू भाई बहुत शानदार वक्ता नहीं थे, बहुत आकर्षक वक्ता नहीं थे, और अंग्रेजी में तो बिल्कुल नहीं थे, हालांकि हिंदी में वो बहुत धारा प्रवाह रूप से बहुत सुंदर बोलते थे। मुझे याद है दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय में सचिदानंद सिन्हा का एक भाषण था, उसमें धीरू भाई को प्रतिक्रिया करनी थी। मुझे नहीं मालूम है कि मैंने किसी भाषण के ऊपर इतनी ज्यादा तुरंत प्रतिक्रिया, सुचिंतित और विचारपूर्ण लंबी और सघन प्रतिक्रिया कभी किसी विद्वान से हिंदी में सुनी हो। इससे प्रभावित होकर पहल हिंदी की बहुत बड़ी पत्रिका है जिसका एक सालाना सम्मान होता है, उस सम्मान में मैं उन्हें ले गया अध्यक्ष बनाकर। वहां भी उन्होंने हिंदी में एक बहुत ही सुंदर और सुचिंतित भाषण दिया था। तो मैं ये मानता हूं कि धीरू भाई एक ऐसे समाज वैज्ञानिक थे जो भारतीय भाषाओं के साथ उनकी उनकी जितनी निकटता थी उतनी और किसी समाज वैज्ञानिक की मैंने नहीं देखी। शायद इसीलिए वो इस उपन्यास की शुरुआत कर पाए और आज हम सब लोग इस उपन्यास को आगे बढ़ाने में लगे हुए हैं। इसका क्लाइमेक्स कब होगा, ये किस दिशा में जाएगा, ये मुझे नहीं पता है, लेकिन अभी तो हम उस उपन्यास के किरदार हैं और धीरे धीरे कर आगे बढ़ रहे हैं। और धीरू भाई की एक और खास बात थी जो मेरे ख्याल से कम मैं नहीं जान पाया हूं किसी और में इस तरह की खास बात होगी। पूरी दिल्ली में मेरी जिंदगी के लिहाज से वो अकेले इंसान थे जिनसे मैं किसी भी निजी मसले के ऊपर राय ले सकता था। निजी मसले, अगर मेरी पत्नी से कोई झगड़ा होता है तो मुझे यकीन था अगर मैं धीरू भाई से उस बारे में राय लूं तो बिल्कुल वो सटीक राय होती थी, उनकी राय व्यवहारिक होती थी, उपयोगी होती थी और उसके अंदर एक एक, एक, एक नैतिक कोर, एक मॉरल कोर भी उनकी उनकी राय में होता था। ऐसा अनूठा व्यक्ति मैंने अपने जीवन में कभी नहीं देखा। एक बार वीपी सिंह ने मुझसे बातचीत करते हुए कहा था कि धीरू भाई इज ए रिजर्वॉयर ऑफ आइडियाज। मैं ये कहूंगा कि वो बिल्कुल नए विचारों का आगार थे। ऐसे योगेंद्र यादव ने अभी कहा ना कि उनके हर वाक्य में लगता था कि एक सोशल साइंस का निबंध है, और ये सही बात है। वो मुझसे कभी कभी मैं कहता था आप धीरू भाई आप किताबें नहीं, आपकी किताबें बहुत कम छपी हैं, तो हमेशा कहते थे कि मैं शॉर्ट स्टोरी राइटर हूं, और सही बात भी है। उन्होंने उनके कम से कम मेरे ख्याल से 100 निबंध होंगे ऐसे। जब जिन दिनों में हिंदी में उनके रीडर का संपादन कर रहा था तो एक बहुत मेरी इच्छा थी कि उनसे एक बहुत लंबा उनके जीवन और कृतित्व के ऊपर उसी तरीके के लंबा इंटरव्यू लूं जैसा मैंने रजनी कोठारी के रीडर का संपादन करते हुए लिया था। तो मैंने उनसे कहा कि मुझे आपका इंटरव्यू लेना है, तो उन्होंने कहा अच्छा पहले मैं अपना एक इंटरव्यू तुम्हें देता हूं, तुम इसको पढ़ लो पहले। तो उन्होंने मुझे मानुषी के पेजों में छपा हुआ अपना एक इंटरव्यू दिया जो कि मधु किश्वर ने लिया था। और जब मैंने उस इंटरव्यू को पढ़ा तो धीरू भाई का जो बौद्धिक व्यक्तित्व था उसका एक नया पहलू मेरे सामने खुला। पूरे इंटरव्यू में मधु किश्वर का हर सवाल पूरी जोरदारी के साथ में आरक्षण विरोध के प्रस्थान बिंदु से शुरू होता है। आप पूरे इंटरव्यू को पढ़िए, इसलिए भी खासतौर से पढ़ने काबिल है। हर प्रश्न ऐसा है जो कि पूरी तरह लोडेड है कि किस रिजर्वेशन क्यों एक घटिया पॉलिसी है, क्यों उसको खत्म कर देना चाहिए। और धीरू भाई का हर सवाल आरक्षण की नीति के समर्थन के प्रस्थान बिंदु से शुरू होता है, जिसमें आरक्षण की नीति की आलोचना भी है, लेकिन साथ में वो जोर देकर उस आरक्षण की नीति की जो जरूरत है भारतीय समाज के लिए, भारतीय राजनीति के लिए, उसकी जो अनिवार्यता है, उस अनिवार्यता का समर्थन करते हुए नजर आते हैं। जो एक इंटरव्यू देने वाले में जो कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस होनी चाहिए और इस तरह से सवालों का खंडन किया जाता है और खंडन करते हुए भी आलोचनात्मक दृष्टि से अपनी बात कही जाती है, ये बात जो धीरू भाई ने कही, धीरू भाई में थी, वो बहुत कम लोगों में दिखी। प्रोफेसर भीकू पारेख ने भी एक बहुत उनके बारे में बात कही जो मैं दोहराना चाहता हूँ यहाँ पर, कि धीरू भाई एक ऐसे विद्वान थे, ऐसे समाज वैज्ञानिक थे जो ये मानते थे कि इस देश ने, इस समाज ने और इस संस्कृति ने मुझे बनाया है और मैं अपना विचार इसी संस्कृति से शुरू, मैं इस संस्कृति और समाज से घृणा नहीं करूंगा। किसी भी वेस्टर्न सोशल थ्योरी के प्रभाव में मैं इससे घृणा नहीं करूंगा, मैं इसकी आलोचना करूंगा, मैं आजाद हूं उसके साथ कोई भी सलूक करने के लिए, और वो मैं सलूक उसके साथ करूंगा, लेकिन मैं किसी विदेशी विद्वान के किसी 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 ग्लोबल और यूनिवर्सल थ्योरी के एक भी रोशनी में उसका खंडन नहीं करूंगा। मुझे याद पड़ता है कि जब नरेंद्र मोदी की दूसरी जीत हुई 2019 में, उसके कुछ महीने बाद मुझे वीवी सिंह और प्रोफेसर राजीव भार्गव के साथ में गुड़गांव जाकर सुहा के घर धीरू भाई से मिलने का मौका मिला और मुझे वहां जाकर ये जानकर एक प्रशंसा हुई। उन्होंने छूटते ही मुझसे कहा कि तुमने मेरे ऊपर जो रीडर बनाया है आजकल मैं उसको पढ़ रहा हूँ। धीरू भाई उसको तो आप पहले ही पढ़ चुके हैं, रीडर बनाई आपके सहयोग से था, बार बार हम हर चीज बनाते थे, आपको दिखाते थे, आपके साथ चर्चा करते थे। बोले नहीं, इतने दिनों के बाद जब मैं उसे पढ़ रहा हूँ तब मुझे लग रहा है कि हिंदी में मेरी बातें काफी ठीक से आ पाई हैं और बहुत सी बातें तो इस तरह आई हैं जो शायद अंग्रेजी में नहीं आ पाई। उनकी बात याद करके मुझे रजनी कोठारी की याद आई। रजनी कोठारी की जब रचना पॉलिटिक्स इन इंडिया का मैंने हिंदी में एक रूपांतर और एक तरह से संवर्धन किया, उसकी भूमिका में प्रोफेसर कोठारी ने लिखा था कि ये पॉलिटिक्स इन इंडिया का ट्रांसलेशन नहीं है बल्कि हिंदी में लिखी गई एक नई किताब। तो धीरू भाई का कहना यही था कि हमारे बहुत से जो लेख हैं उसमें तुमने बातचीत करके जो मेरे साथ चीजें जोड़ी हैं वो उससे वो उनमें एक ऐसा नयापन आ गया है जो कि अंग्रेजी के उसमें नहीं है। मैं केवल यही कहूँगा कि धीरू भाई का व्यक्तित्व अनूठा था और उन्होंने जो उपन्यास लिखा उसके पात्र के रूप में आज भी मैं अपना किरदार निभा रहा हूँ और उन्हीं के निर्देशों के मुताबिक निभा रहा हूँ। उसमें जो स्पिरिट थी, जो जज्बा था उनके निर्देशों में, उसके मुताबिक निभा रहा हूँ और मुझे उम्मीद है कि हम लोगों से जो वो उम्मीद करते थे उस उम्मीद पर हम खड़े उतरेंगे और मैं समझता हूँ कि उनकी मुझे बहुत याद आएगी। इसके अलावा और मैं कुछ कह पाने की स्थिति में।
थैंक यू अभय। आई नाउ इनवाइट शेयर मायरा एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट ऑफ कल्चर सिविलाइजेशन एंड माय कलीग एट सीएलटीएस टू मेक हर इंटरवेंशन।
थैंक यू रवि। Go to Ashish. These are the first words that Dhiru Bhai spoke to me when I went to see him in 1990. I just finished my MPhil from the Delhi School of Economics, and I told him that I want to work on myth and history. So this is basically how I was dismissed. His own domain was power, politics, caste, and social movements. And this I would realize over a period of time when I joined the center and was a participant in the center's extended lunch. A large number of subjects were discussed. For instance, among Hindus, names of persons are most often those of gods and goddesses. Indian sociology and also the contribution of European sociologists was, you know, often taken apart, rendered threadbare, because Dhiru Bhai was working on caste, and he had this, you know, is moving towards this grand theorization on caste. And Louis Dumont, of course, was often a victim of critique. He had greater sympathy for Pocock. Another critical point, for instance, I remember him making is why the Congress Party had created a huge problem in Assam by not paying attention to the Bengali influx. And of course, we know how that's grown into the, you know, the Constitution Amendment Act. The center's past flowed into me, as it were, through conversation with Dhiru Bhai. And in a sense, in retrospect, I look, you know, at the tremendous energy of the project. I mean, 1964 is the moment of its formation, and then the premises shift from Kashmiri Gate. And what I want to emphasize is the relationship between theory and practice. 1975, emergency, the center became a huge hub of dissent. In fact, sections of the Janata Party manifesto, you know, and what would be a political vision of an alternative were drafted there. 1984, the anti-Sikh violence. There was not only the involvement with saving lives, but also then the deeper attempt to understand and reflect on violence. And in the 1980s, again, the whole growth of social movements, the refugees of development, the underclass, Dhirubhai, you know, insisting that there's really no room for the Aboriginal and the outcast, because 60% of the refugees of development are either Dalits or Adivasis. The center was known for its Gujarat mafia, and I put that in quotes, and Gujarat was also the epicenter of capitalist development, the Narmada, you know, Sagar project and so on. And there was a keen realization, especially felt by Dhirubhai, that a new kind of social science was required for this particular moment. Through Dhirubhai, I was actually drawn into many circles, Lokayan, Lokniti, the Indian Languages Program. He was also a major figure in the People's Union for Civil Liberties. And mujhe yaad hai ki ek kitab pe charcha thi, Swaroop Dhruv ki Ummeed Hogi Koi. Isme Dhirubhai mujhe leke gaya, unne bola ki iske upar bolo. Aur ek jisme ye ye baat thi ki jo hinsa ke baad, हिंसा के बाद जो है उसका जो aftermath है किस तरह का हो सकता है. He also had an extremely complex position on nationalism, and some of my other colleagues have alluded to that. And I think that what's interesting is the kind of different positions that would taken by Ashishta and by Dhirubhai on nationalism. And I think that this is actually a very important debate. Also on Indian thought, I want to draw your attention to the fact that it was Surubhi Ben really who was the impetus of his, you know, great interest in Indian thought. And he was a serious reader of texts. She had a group actually, which would meet on Sundays and would discuss, you know, texts like the Upanishads and so on. And I remember Dhirubhai making a comment that the ways in which the Jain critique had been folded into Indian philosophy, there was also wonderful Gujarati food which came out from Surabhi Ben's kitchen. And I think it's very important to make a reference because that was part of the aesthetic of the lunch. Among the most enjoyable evenings that I had in Delhi were the addas that I had with Dhirubhai, Ashishta, Rajiv. And lastly, I must share with you that however much Dhirubhai might have had a village background, but he also knew how to shake a leg. And at Aranyani's wedding, I said to Dhirubhai, dance karenge. And I learned that he was quite with it because he clearly did some version of the foxtrot. So Dhirubhai, you know, I can't believe today that we're speaking about you in the past tense. But you've been so significant to the ways in which the center's grown, the ways in which I have grown, and I'm just going to miss you terribly. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Cher. Thank you for that intervention. I now invite Milun Kothari. Milun is an activist and a human rights advocate. He's also a scholar. Milun, thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. Namaskar. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. It's like for others, a very difficult moment for me. In a sense, it happened recently when Surabhi Ben passed away, and you know, now with Dhirubhai, it always brings back, of course, my parents, Rajnibhai and Hansabhai, and I somehow see them all as sort of one unit. And I was very, you know, fortunate to have grown up with multiple fathers in a way. I had Dhirubhai and Ashishtha, and there's some sort of distinguishing, I don't know what we can call them, features that I remember growing up as a child and, you know, running around playing, talking during the addas that took place at number one Court Road with all of my father's friends and colleagues. And I think that what I always found with Dhirubhai was he was very approachable, very humble, calm, jovial, always the one, you know, making the jokes. And also what I really appreciated was the, with both him and Subhiben, was the simplicity with which they lived. And it's a kind of, you know, ethical lives that we all desperately need today in the world. And in a sense, we had a, I mean, our children, Smitu, Ashish and I, there was a particular bond, maybe because of the Gujarati background, maybe because Dhirubhai had known my father in Vadodara, and in a sense, it was a, you know, Surbiben was always a great support as well. I remember she came and lived with us in Noida when my mother was ill before she passed away. And I think that there was something that I learned and really admired and was amazed at was the close friendship that my father had. Very deep friendship, sort of rarely seen with Dhirubhai and Ashishtha. There was a kind of a, you know, automatic trust and confidence. And in a sense, you know, when we look back today, I think we remember, we must remember this amazing collective that was there at CSDS. And I think that I don't, you know, I mean, there are particular incidences from my childhood, but I think one of the aspects I remember is my father always, you know, saying that Dhiruvai ne puchhiye, you know, if there was something we were confused about or something, he would always say, let's ask Dhirubhai his opinion or his advice. And then when I came of age, you know, started working on human rights, I always found Dhirubhai's thoughts and words very inspiring. And in fact, something that stood out, because while many people had in the 80s and 90s given up on the role of the state, Dhirubhai was always very convinced about holding the state accountable. And that sort of gelled very well with the work that you were all doing on human rights. And I think we see today, you know, the conditions we're in when the state is not responsible and is abrogating its duties. I always found in him a very keen supporter of the human rights terminology, instruments and mechanisms. And also his, of course, his work at PUCL. I remember one moment in particular in 1993 when Dhirubhai and Kuldeep Nair had made their way to Vienna for the World Conference on Human Rights. And, you know, we were all talking about very sort of broad ideas and they were very helpful in grounding us. So I of course will miss Dhirubhai and Surbiben terribly. And I want to also remember Surbiben, who played such a similarly essential supportive role like Hansabhai and my mother did for my father. And it's very clear that neither of them would have had the inspirational careers that they did without Subhiben and Hansabhai. And I just want to say it's very hard in a way to speak at this time, but I want to sort of pledge a renewed commitment in my own work and on human rights and democracy, and want to revisit Dhirubhai's writings. And Ashishtha, I just wanted to say that when my father passed away, you and I was very, very upset. You had told me that Milun, don't be sad. Your father lived a a productive and long life, and achieved a lot and left a very long legacy. And I don't know if I'm too young, too junior for you, but if I can give you the same advice, I think Dhirubhai has left a remarkable legacy that we've all been hearing about today. And I think we need to go on. And I just want to say that there are a lot of us younger who are trying to continue. We may never be able to fill your shoes or shoes of Dhirubhai or my father, but we are trying. Thank you.
Thank you, Milo. Thank you. Thank you very much. And last, we have Soha. Soha cared for Dhirubhai for many, many years. And Soha was a very important part of his life. So Soha, please.
Thank you, Ravi. I think this is one of the toughest speaking moments for me. And I'm so overwhelmed with all of you here who have been papas, friends, and family, and my family, especially in the last 4 or 5 years. I've been in touch with all of you in my drawing room, witnessing the heated debates. And that really brings me to my childhood when, you know, I wanted to share this, because when I'm hearing all of you and when you're telling about Papa, about him as a personality in the intellectual space, but, you know, it's no different when I see him as my father. Because with Papa, it's what you get, what you see, and what you see, what you get, right? So in my childhood, you know, I used to witness these heated debates on various issues in our living room. And I used to, especially when I used to hear Papa, I used to wonder, is he a secular? Is he a liberal? Is he a Gandhian? Is he an Ambedkar? What is he? And I thought, I'm too young, so I'm not able to understand. But when I grew up, I realized that was the beauty of Papa's way of putting his thoughts, right? He was never in any kind of a bucket. And I think coming back to me as a daughter, and I can't say anything about Papa without Mummy. And both of them, I'm so fortunate. Both of us, me and Inayat, actually Inayat could not be here because he's got some shoulder injury. Both of us have been given a space where, whether it was a school, choice of the school, Sardar Patel, or at home, it was very similar. We were allowed to say what we want to. We were allowed to fight over all the issues we had to with parents without being a hierarchy of that sort. I mean, I have fought with my dad till the end on various issues. And it has been so healthy because it just ends with the concept or with the issue you're fighting on. And it just doesn't stay beyond that. So I think I've been very fortunate to be in that space with my parents. My parents led very, very simple life, really simple life sometimes, to the point that it used to get a little frustrating for us as a growing children. But when you grow up, you realize what it really meant and why did they do that, right? They really practiced and without really imposing it onto you. I think the last thing what I really wanted to say was about Papa, because this is really helping me to heal. Thank you so much, all of you, because, you know, it's very tough when you are nursing your dad and a dad who is so spirited. You've all been in witnessing COVID and you must be very familiar with the SpO2 level, and Papa's SpO2 level for last 5 years on an average used to be in his 80s. And that was a comfortable SpO2 level for him. So you can imagine the level of illness he had in term and the struggle. But he never, ever complained about his ill health. He never, ever said, why is this has happened to me? He loved his drink in the evening. He enjoyed speaking to his friends on phone. And I used to have that fight every evening about controlling his drinks and all, being a daughter and primary caretaker. But he loved his evening. He enjoyed till the end. My husband Uday actually was in his BiPAP, and he said that you get just Saturday is coming, we have to have our drink. And he's in the BiPAP said, why not now? So that's what he, you know, he was like, he was always in the moment. And last thing is, you know, I don't know. I didn't catch that in, but he had a black humor. His humor was never, it was sarcasm and it was black. So being a daughter, I used to complain that, you know, I want to hear your humor, which is like not black, Papa. But he could not do without it because he was always, because that also is one thing which I have learned, that you cannot, everything you analyze is in a critical sense of its word, and you cannot just take it as it, as anything is as obvious as that. So I think, yeah, I'm really overwhelmed, and I'm so happy to see all of you in this room, in the audience. Uma Mashi, I wish you speak something, and because all of you are my family, and I'm having this uncanny feeling that I'm going to maybe lose this connect, which I want to really preserve with myself. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Soha, for that. And that was really lovely. And what is remarkable is in the audience, we see a lot of old CSGS friends, a lot of old CSGS friends who've been part of the CSGS community. So there are two ways. We've been here for 2 hours. So there are two ways we can do this. You can send a text if you would like to speak. We can put on your audio, and or if you want to speak, you know, properly with video, we can put on, you know, get you on the panel, or we can send it to send it on the Q&A. And I see an intervention from Atul Kota, who speaks of his meeting with Rajni and Giri, and also meeting Smitu and Shekhar Singh, and he sends his best wishes today. And I can see that Douglas Loomis has raised his hand, and wait. Let's
see this. Does that mean you can hear me now?
Yes, we can. We can. Please speak. Please speak.
Oh, good. I don't have much of a right to speak very much to you folks, but I can't pass up this opportunity to greet you and to thank you for sending me an invitation to this event, and to say how moved I was listening to you talk about the person I knew as Mr. Chef. One of my failures during the time I was at CSDS, so 1 year plus 1 month, was a failure to work hard to develop a relationship with that wonderful man. We had several good conversations, and it's very interesting that I remember that we talked about democracy. I also noticed from your notice that Mr. Sheth and I were born in the same year. And so I have an excuse for having a bad memory. But while I can't put into words in any memory of those conversations, almost everything I heard you say made me think, yes, that's him. Yes, that's him. There was something that communicated to me from those brief conversations about the depth of his wisdom, the humor, and the fact that he was one of those rare people who you could talk to about democracy. Democracy is something that people usually exchange platitudes about, but as all of you said, whatever subject he talked on, he had something surprising to say. I just want to say one more thing. And that is, I think, as you know, I've lived many years in Japan and now Okinawa. I still live there. We still live there. And so most of the funerals or memorials that I've been to have been in Okinawa and Japan. And many people find those events, many people from other countries, especially mine, are shocked by the fact that people at those gatherings are often surprisingly cheerful. Sometimes they have a little snack and drink beer. And people from other countries wonder if they have no feelings, whether don't have adequate sympathy. But that's not the point. The point is that people at those gatherings take it for granted that the deceased person is listening. Not as true believers in some religion, but just as common sense that, of course, the person is listening. Sometimes the speakers who speak take the microphone and talk to the deceased person. And the point is to assure that person that we're going to do all right. Even without you, we'll bear it. We're not going to all quarrel with each other. We're going to keep the extended family operating, and we'll be okay. And listening to you, I thought the person I called Mr. Seth, is blessed to have this community remembering him, this community which, as I can understand from what you were saying, he was instrumental in creating. He was one of the architects of this community that can remember him with the depth and the sensitivity and the wisdom that you folks have expressed. I think he was a blessing to you, and as I was learned today that you are also a blessing to him. Okay, that's all. Thank you for the opportunity to talk.
Thank you, Dr. I would, Jayanta Bandhupadhyay, what would you like to speak? Please put your audio on.
Am I muted? Okay. No, I'm done talking.
You need to be, yeah. Yes. We can't hear you, sir. This is Jayanta Bandhupadhyay. You need to unmute yourself. Okay. Now, what we'll do is we go to Smita. We go to Smita. Smita, you want? Would you like to talk? Raise your hand, Smita Tiwari, just so. Smita, if you'd like to speak, you'd like to unmute yourself. Yes, I think Jayanta Bandyopadhyay has unmuted himself. Would you like to speak, sir?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Are you addressing me?
Yes, yes, absolutely. You
are... Yes. I am Dhiru Bhai's younger brother. My name is Madhu Bhai Seth. And first of all, I'd like to thank you, Ravi Bhai, for letting me participate. What I am is because of my older brother, Dhiru Bhai. We have a difference of about 2.5 years in age. But there was rarely a sense of any sibling rivalry or anything like that. And I have witnessed all his achievements, his failures, his success, despair. I try to read as much as I can what he had written about the social issues or his CSDS article or everything. I just like to add a few things. So has covered lots of grounds. In his last days or last few years, he cannot, breathing was not good. He was not reading newspaper a lot. Writing was out of questions. So I thought we two brothers will connect some way. I joined a book club of here and we had a book on existentialism. I sent him that book and we... And he was very sharp minded about even this, though he left that existentialism topic some 20 or 30 years ago, but he was very sharp. He participated. He suggested many things. I used to discuss in our book club also. Then my viewpoint, everything is black and white. You know, Heidegger, when I found out Heidegger had a Nazi sympathies, I dumped him. But Dhiru Bhai understood even Heidegger. And he was, even had a brief for Heidegger that no, he was okay. He was not a bad person in all respect. So that's what I found him very interesting about it. He had a balanced outlook for many topics. To you, Guy, if you are interested. About this reservation in last days, I asked him that what to do with this reservation. See, everyone wants reservation right from Prosperous Patel to Gujjars to Prosperous Jats or everyone. I say, what is your solution? He told me that now they should have a rotation, some kind, people who got reservation. Should not, their children should not enjoy reservation. That was his kind of a solution, I would say. So many things I like to talk about his childhood also, that what has made him tick, or even when he was 15 years old, my father wanted him to be a lawyer or say a civil servant. But he told us that, look, we have those cobblers living all around. I want to find a cooperative for these cobblers, buy the leather for them and distribute them and help them. So from very young age, he was a very involved person. So far the people are concerned. That is the one thing I notice about him, and that's what he did for whole his life. I don't want to add more. I think I will finish here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. It's been a very long evening today. And we will not continue this because it's been very long and it would be unfair to the participants. Please write in any comments you have to the CSDS and we will be happy to incorporate them when we do the final video. So it's been a very difficult and actually I think life-affirming session for us. The larger center community is here. We've also lost people today apart from Dhirubhai. Sundar Lal Bhaguna passed today. So it is, in a way, you feel a generation has come to an end. But it hasn't. Again, as I said, it hasn't. And we must, I think, distill some of the thoughts that the speakers have brought. And I really want to today take this occasion of thanking all of you, fellow panelists, for taking out time. It's not been easy for some of you to speak today. And I can see that in some of the interventions, but it would really mean a lot. And I also like the fact that you brought in this peculiar sparkle in Dhirubhai's eyes. He was a ready wit. He liked to laugh. He liked to pull people's leg. So it's this combination of thought and laughter, extremely life affirming. So I want to thank all of you for coming here today. We are going to end this session. It's set up as a memorial, but it's not. It's a celebration of Dhirubhai's thought. And I hope we can continue to do that. Thank you.